Praise the Lord, brethren. We bless God for another time out in His presence. And tonight God is leading us to foundation. We are beginning to lay a foundation. And the reason why we need to lay this foundation is because Christ has promised us so many things. You know, He told us that we eat poison and it will not harm us. He told us we'll tread upon serpents and scorpions and they will do us no harm. He told us that all power will be given to us via the name of Jesus. He told us He will provide all our daily needs. He told us that darkness will not be able to overcome us. The promises He gave us are so enormous. But brethren, this is where I started my walk with God. I came to the realization that what I live is not exactly what He said. I came to a realization that the way my life is running is not at par with what He promised. And this is not a matter of someone trying to play us religious words, you know, trying to confuse us with too much religious nonsense and big words. No. Simple. Jesus Christ said, I'm going to get to a position in Him where I will command and things will happen. Where I will have a tiny faith like a mustard seed, and I will tell a mountain to move, and the mountain has no choice but to move. Now I have been in Christ for 6 months, for 1 year, for 2 years, for 5 years, for 10 years. I am still not telling the mountain to move, and it moves. I have not gotten to a position where I am confident that if they give me poison, I will not die. I have not gotten to the position where I command the devil to get out and he flees. If I have not gotten to that position, something is wrong. And it is two ways. Two simple ways about it. Either I am not doing it the way I should do it, or the stuff itself does not work. And that was a position I got to after, if I want to pick it up as an adult, since the day I think I gave my life to Jesus Christ, and I look at how far, it's been over 20 years. From the day I remember I gave my life to Jesus Christ, it's been 20 years. As at then, when I came to this realization, it's been over 20 years. And yet I cannot cast out demons. I still run after men of God to, you know, pray for me, to do something for me. And I begin to ask myself questions. Okay, is it that this Bible cannot happen? Jesus, you know, didn't promise this thing. And so all these things they wrote in the Bible was a lie. Or is it that it's the truth? It is me that I've not gotten it right. So that was one of the things that God used to wake up my sense to start asking questions, to start studying the Bible, to start going through many parts of the Bible, to start reading the Bible for myself, to find out, okay, is this thing true? What the Bible says, is it real? And I discovered it is real. And it is my discovery that yes, God is real. That is what God has used to bring us to where we are today. And, you know, the more we teach the truth about the Bible, and the more we open our eyes to the truth about the Bible, somehow the more little and inconsequential we become to you. And that is how it's supposed to be. The more we open your eyes to see the Bible and see the provisions that Christ has made for you, the more you see yourself, becoming what we are today. And the more you don't really need us for miracles, rather you need us to share the word of God together, to open your eyes better, so you can see better and become what God has created you to become. So the more you know Christ, the less reliance you have on Brother Femi and Brother Gbile and all the others. The more, so naturally, if you have spent 1 year with us, 3 years with us, 10 years with us, you should have gotten to a stage where you are no longer waiting for us to decree, but God is taking you to a place where even you can now decree for others. And I pray that God will lift all of us there in Jesus' name. So, the reason why... Okay, I remember my wife have told me to stop saying the reason why, because both of them are the same thing. So, the reason you haven't been able to fulfill exactly the promises that Christ has, you know, written down for us in the Bible could be because of our foundation is faulty, and we need to deal with our foundation urgently. Could be that right from the beginning we did not get it right. You know, there are some things like men will understand this, let me take general ones first. A few of us that know how to cook. If from the beginning of your cooking you've gotten it wrong, it will be difficult to get it right along the way. It's going to cost a lot. Imagine when you are trying to prepare the sauce, you have oversalted the sauce. Many times you have to now go and look for other things in their excesses to increase the sauce for no reason, so that you could have more quantity of others to absorb the salt, or you have to discard and start afresh. Praise the Lord. So if the foundation of our Christianity has an issue, whatever we build on it will be wrong. And we'll be reading the promises of God, and it will never actually manifest exactly as Christ has said it. You know, when anytime I hear people talk about you take poison and you will not die, when they quote the part of the Bible, it becomes real to me, because I started this year by being poisoned. And God, through God, I did not die. So, those promises in the Bible will now become life to you when we get the foundations correct. Even myself that is speaking to you, God is still taking me to some key things in the foundation and pulling it off. I went through some of our prayers some few years ago, and I smiled that I cannot pray this kind of prayers again. We cannot pray this, we cannot send this kind of prayers out again, because God has helped us to correct some foundational errors, to understand Him better and follow strictly the Bible. So, brethren, that is where we are starting today. I don't know how far and how long it will take God to open our eyes to understand into His understanding and help us to lay a new foundation. But I want to beg of you to ensure that you allow God carry you through this season, through these lessons, through these teachings, so that a new foundation that is solid can be laid in our lives, and our Christian race can be as Christ designed it to be. And I also want to put this caveat that you being a pastor for 40 years does not mean that the foundation is correct. That you've been around and following Christ for 75 years does not mean that the foundation is correct. So we need to examine that foundation and look at it very well. I pray that God will open our eyes, open our hearts, and help us to understand this in Jesus' name. We ask for the presence of our teacher, the Holy Spirit, the only sanctified teacher by Jesus. We ask you to please come in here now to teach us. and not just while I speak, but to everyone that is listening and everyone that will listen, that you will help us to open the Bible, to understand it more, and take us deeper into your word to lay a correct foundation for our walk with Christ. In Jesus' mighty name we are prayed. Amen. So, let's start from the very foundation. And tonight, I will not go into preaching that much. I just want to lay a foundation. Thank God of recent, God has been helping us to always advise you that after we have finished this teaching, please go to the Bible. Read it for yourself. Confirm what we have said. Then hold on to the truth. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. Okay, so let's just take, let's go into our Bible verse for tonight. I will not be preaching that much. I just want us to lay a foundation. John chapter 15 verse 1. John chapter 15 verse 1. I am the true vine. That's Jesus speaking. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, Jesus is saying here that I am the true vine. You know, a vine is a plant. And it has branches. So Jesus is saying, I am the true vine. So there were other vines that we can branch to. You know, he said that we are the branches. God the Father is the one that is nurturing the plant. So Jesus is the plant. We are the branches. So we, you know, a branch takes its root inside the vine, while the vine takes its root inside the soil. And the husbandman and the ground and everything is God the Father. Jesus is the plant, and we are the branches. So if Jesus is saying, I am the true vine, it means that there are other vines, but they are not the true vine. We can call them the fake vines. So if Jesus is the true, then they are the false vines. And the true one is the original one. That is, if Jesus is the original, then we have fake. I hope we are getting that clearly. So, now, why is Jesus saying that he is the true vine? Let's look at it very well. And why is he speaking to us now that we should take our root in him? Our root should be inside of him. Let's look at it very well. I want you to note that Christianity, which Jesus came to lay the foundation, did not start before Jesus. Because a person couldn't have been a Christian who has not met Jesus. Please, I'm taking my time because I want us to get this very clearly. Jesus says he is the vine, and you know, he is the Christ, and it's on him we have the foundation of Christianity. So when you say anything Christianity, it is on the foundation of Christ, because Christianity means Christ-like, a person that has a life that looks like that of Christ. So when you pick Christ and you pick the person, the life is exactly the same thing. Now, a person couldn't have had Christ's life when the person never met Christ. Hope you're understanding. Christ-like means I am copying Christ. I am imitating Christ. There's a place where Brother Paul talks about imitating Christ. So, Christ, a Christian is a person that imitates Christ, is a copycat of Christ's life. Is a person that looks at Christ and says, okay, if Christ does it this way, that's exactly how I'm doing it. If Christ does it that way, that's exactly how I'm doing it. So it's a copycat. Now, you couldn't have copied what you have not seen. If you copy, if you do something before the original person did it, then you become the original. The original person now becomes the copycat. So when we talk about Christianity, it came with Christ. It was when Christ came that Christianity came. So everyone that was born and died without meeting Christ could never have been like Christ because they never met him. I'm laying a foundation and I want us to understand. So Christianity started with Christ. Everyone that now looks at Christ and says, I can see Christ, this was what Christ said, this was what Christ did, this was how Christ responded, and I'm going to copy that life. I'm going to imitate that life. That person becomes a Christian. Moses never met Christ. So Moses is not a Christian because he couldn't see Christ to copy. I hope you are following. Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, David, Elijah, Elisha, and the whole host of them were not Christians because they never met Christ. They never saw Christ, so they couldn't have copied Christ. They have no Christ to copy and say, okay, well, this was how Jesus responded, so this is how I will respond according to Christ. So when you look at from the Old Testament, the person that met Christ, that was supposed to be like Christ, the only person in the Old Testament that had opportunity to learn of Christ was Adam. And before he finished his discipleship class, he has left to go and commit sin. And Christ has left him alone. Because he was the one that when God was walking, used to come as a voice to walk in the garden. That was why when Jesus came and John the Baptist was about to be killed. He had been arrested. Or around that time. And John the Baptist asked people to go and meet Jesus. So ask, are you the Christ? Because I believe in you. When Jesus Christ came, John the Baptist believed in Jesus. Not only did he believe in Jesus, he has even been preaching about Jesus before Jesus came. He has been making way for Jesus. And when he saw Jesus, he believed so much in Jesus that he had to say, I cannot touch the sole of your shoe. And Jesus said, no, baptize me so that this can just be fulfilled. So John the Baptist believed in Jesus. And that's why Jesus told the people around him that John the Baptist is greater than everybody that have been born of man. Everyone that have been born of a woman, John the Baptist is greater than them. Why? Because John the Baptist was the first person who believed so much in Jesus, even before the disciples of Jesus believed him. Before the disciples started seeing signs and wonders and started believing, John the Baptist had believed in Jesus. He was one of the first people that we can call a Christian who saw Jesus and said, I believe in this one, I'm going to follow this one. That's why Jesus said, John the Baptist is greater than everyone born of a woman. Jesus excluded Adam. Why? Adam met Jesus. Are we getting it? Adam met Jesus. Jesus used to come in the garden to have meetings with Adam. So for Adam to have met Jesus, it is the key of his greatness. The next person that believed in Jesus is now John the Baptist. And Jesus said, of all the people that have been born of a woman, the greatest amongst them is John the Baptist, who believed in Jesus. So The foundation of our Christianity is Jesus. And everyone that meets Jesus and believes in Jesus is naturally greater than everyone that was in the Old Testament. We'll come back to that later. So now you're going to be asking me, if the people in the Old Testament were not Christians, then what were they? If they were not Christians, what were they? And I want to take us back again. I know we said we are laying foundation for our Christianity, so we're going to take our time. If we can't finish it tonight, we'll continue tomorrow, but God will help us to lay a correct foundation so that we can build on it and be what Christ wants us to be. When Adam and Eve did not sin, they were not making sacrifices. They were not coming with animals to God to kill. They were not even bringing fruits to God to a sacrifice, because there was no sin. And everything in the garden belongs to God. Adam and Eve had nothing. So they had no scores to bring tithe, offering, sacrifice, or whatever, thanksgiving, or whatever thing to God. They had no cause. They were right with God. Everything they owned did not belong to them. It belonged to God. Then they sinned. Could you note with me that after they sinned, the next interaction with God was no longer a simple interaction. It became a religious ritual where they needed to bring sacrifice to God. That was when Cain and Abel brought sacrifices to God. Adam and Eve, when there was no sin, never brought any sacrifices. They never needed any sacrifices because God himself was coming to meet them. So they didn't need a sacrifice to draw the attention of God to themselves. But when sin came, Cain and Abel needed to go to God now with a sacrifice. So, the foundation of sacrifice and the religion and spiritual rituals came out of sin. And this has been in place immediately man fell. So when man fell, men could not have contact with God. So men had to devise other means of doing sacrifices in order to gain God's attention. So it was not when Moses came that he now brought the law of sacrifices. Moses only standardized it into standard laws for the Israelites. Before we had anything called Israelites at all, sacrifices has been done. We all know that Abraham is actually the father of Moses and the old Israelites. He didn't have opportunity to read the law of Moses because Moses has not been born. Yet, if you note with me, Abraham always makes an altar, kills an animal on that altar as a sacrifice to God to get the attention of God. So the law of Moses did not start with Moses. It had always been the way, since man fell, man went into rituals in order to gain God. And it was not only godly people that do rituals. The people of Baal also do rituals. All other worshippers, they do rituals. They have these high places where they kill children. Newborn babies, to go and kill them on that altar, they also do rituals. So when God told Abraham to kill his son, it wasn't strange. It wasn't something that has never happened before. People were doing sacrifices and killing their sons and daughters and wives and everything. But it was difficult. It was a painful thing for Abraham because that was the promise that God gave him. It was difficult. And he has never found that from God. So it was difficult. So what foundation are we laying? Before Moses came, which every other person followed, there had been a form of religion of sacrifice, of sacrifices, which came from sin. When man did not sin, man did not have to bring sacrifices to God. Man was enjoying the fellowship of God. He had God already. And man had nothing except God. So, since he had nothing and all he had belongs to God, the whole garden becomes God. Because when he sinned, what did God do? God chased him out of his garden. If the garden belonged to Adam, God will not be chasing Adam out of Adam's garden. God will leave the garden for Adam. But God was the owner of the garden. So he said, hey, get out of my garden. Out. It's my property. Go and get your own. This is my own. I was the one that created this one. I only put you there. So, right from the beginning, Adam and Eve did not bring any sacrifices, did not kill any animals, did not do anything. Everything they had belongs to God. And God was coming down from heaven to fellowship with them. Immediately they sinned, they went into making sacrifices. So, a religion sort of was formed where we had to go to God. And it was the same with every other religion around. It wasn't different. If you go and study Baal, how they worship Baal, it's not too much different. The only thing they did was they killed human beings for sacrifices. They had that killing of human beings. They had that sex and all this nonsense. That's where we have the altar prostitutes and many things added to it. So they were adding sin to it. But when it comes to sacrificing, making an image or building an altar, they were doing that. So the name that was now given to what the Israelites did, the name that was given to it was Judaism. So what they were worshipping, the religion they were following is called Judaism. It's taken from the way the Judea, the way you worship God. So it was given a name, Judaism. That's the making of sacrifices, the killing of animals, and all the rest. That was all that Abraham did. Isaac followed. Jacob followed. The Israelites followed. And Moses picked up and converted it into a law. If you go back to study the Bible very well, you will discover that God gave 10 commandments. And those 10 commandments are still in vogue to date, sort of. But the laws of Moses were the things that are happening around, the things that were already being done by his forefathers, legalizing it now. So, Moses was not a Christian, and all his laws were not Christian laws. He never met Christ. He only practiced what he got from his fathers. He only practiced what has always been in vogue, even before he was born. Before he was born, they've been making altars and been killing animals on it and been bringing... It was a normal thing then that when you meet a priest, you give the priest 10%. It's been in vogue. There was no place in the Bible where we were told that and God came to Abraham and taught Abraham how to create altars. There was no place like that. God did not teach Abraham brand new how to create an altar. It was in vogue. It has always been happening. How to bring animals to kill and fruits to the altar. It has been since Cain and Abel. Before anybody started writing, before we started writing and putting, having language that we can write down, before God scattered the language at the Tower of Babel, they've been sacrificing. So when Abraham gave 10% also, he gave what was happening around. What other people used to give to their priests, sort of. He followed the same way. And you know, he did not give 10% out of his own goods. He gave 10% out of what he won, the spoils of war. The altar he made is also gotten from around. That is how people now connect with God. So it's either you are doing it to connect with God, or you are doing it to connect with the devil or demons. But it's just something that has been in vogue. So I needed us to understand that right from after Adam sinned, everyone that was born, right till John the Baptist, none of them is a Christian. None, not one of them is a Christian. The Christianity now started with Jesus again for those who come in contact and believe in Jesus. And that's why Jesus is saying in the book of John chapter 15 verse 1, I am that he is now the true vine. There is another vine of Judaism, of offering sacrifices, of priesthoods, a special priest on the in the temple. There was a religion that was going on before, and people have to follow after it. And it has the difference between that religion and the other religions is just the holiness. But even with that, they added their own flavors to it. For instance, if a man is tired of his wife, he just woke up one day and say, I'm tired of you. I'm tired of you. I'm not even looking fine again. See the way you're looking haggard. You can write a letter of divorcement for her and send her away. Then marry a young one. Then when that one has given birth again or something happened, you just say, get out. Let me take another one again. Or you can even marry plenty as much as possible. So they added their own flavors to it. So when Jesus came, Jesus said, no. In the beginning, when we started it, that's not how. They've tampered with it. But no problem. They were doing religion. But now, here I am. I am the true vine now. The Christian life is now based on me. Christianity is now on the foundation of Jesus. So, if our Christian life has been based on a foundation of the things we read in the Old Testament, then we have not built a Christian foundation. We have built a Judaism foundation. Now, I'll take it again and I'll be slow this time around. Christianity started with Jesus. And you know, when Jesus went to the Mount of Transfiguration, God spoke and said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Hear ye him. The person you are going to listen to now, from now on, is my Son. And Jesus, who we are told to listen to, said, he is now the true vine. It is upon him that Christianity is founded. Now, so if we now found our own walk with God based on the Old Testament, then we are basing it on Judaism, a religion, not on Christianity, on Christ. So, all the stories that we read in the Old Testament gives us a clue of how God relates with his people. But they are not our instruction, because they were instructions on Judaism. They were instructions on religion, not on Christianity. So if we now say, because Elijah sent down fire on top of his enemy, we too now go and start looking for fire for our enemy. What are we practicing, brethren? We are practicing Judaism. It's a religion, another vine, not the true vine. Because when we come to the true vine says, pray for your enemies. It did not say pray against them. Because someone will say, we are praying, we are praying. Pray for, not pray against. So, if we now go to Psalms and start reading it for our instruction of how to deal with enemy, deal with people, or how to worship God and know God better, what are we looking at? We are looking at those who practice Judaism, which was the religion that God allowed us at then, which was not perfect. If it was perfect and okay, Christ would not need to come again to lay a new foundation and a correct one. Something was wrong with Judaism. And that's what Brother Paul was trying to explain. That if the law could help, then we should have done everything with the law. The law should have been okay. Judaism should have been perfect. But Jesus Christ came to correct it because Judaism was not perfect. Judaism was not right. And that was why Jesus went ahead to break the symbol of Judaism. Before he left the finish his work, he ensured that he broke the symbol of Judaism, the epitome of Judaism, which was the temple. The temple, you know, in those days, you cannot worship God anywhere except you go to the temple. Anywhere you are, you cannot worship God. You need to go to the temple. If you have not gotten to the temple, that religion has not been certified. So the epitome of Judaism, which was practiced before Jesus came, was the temple. And that was why when the disciples of Jesus were showing Jesus the temple, Jesus said, in 3 days, we'll break it down. Within 3 days, we'll raise a new one. And you will note with me that as Jesus was on the cross, what happened? There was an earthquake. When the earthquake happened, it was a serious earthquake that the mountain shaked. If a mountain can shake, brethren, what happened to the temple? The temple shook. The temple shook. The temple scattered. That's why the curtain that was there was torn. And the place that God used to stay, the holies of holies, where God stays within the temple, was open for all to see, and God left. The symbol of Judaism was torn down, was broken, and that was the end of Judaism. From then on, we now have the blood of Jesus, the life of Jesus, the cross of Jesus, which is now the new foundation. It was not another religion, brethren. Because religion could not help us. So it is no longer about religion. It's now about a life. We'll be going to that one later. But I needed to lay the foundation that everything but that Moses wrote, all the lifestyle of Abraham, the lifestyle of Moses, of Jacob, of Isaac, of Isaiah, of Jeremiah, Nahum, Ezra, Jonah, and all of them. What are they? Judaism. They were based on religion called Judaism. That's the name we gave it. It's not that God said from heaven and said, I am giving you guys Judaism now. No. That's the name theologians gave to understand that kind of religion. Just like, you know, we have Islam. We have, these guys, Undis, what's their name? Buddhists. Yeah. We have Shango worshippers. We have Ifa worshippers. And that's why if you take your time to look at our traditional religion, compare it with Judaism, you will discover that they are not too far from one another. The only difference is that one asks for holiness and righteousness, while the other one is satisfying sin. But when you look at how it all works out, they are both the same foundation. In Judaism, the key is a shrine called the temple. The temple is the shrine of Judaism. It has a chief priest. And you bring sacrifices to that temple to worship the God of that temple. Same way goes to Shango worshippers. For those who are not Nigerian, Shango is a demonic deity in Nigeria that is being worshipped by the Yoruba speaking side of Nigeria. And there is a popular one that we all might know, the God of Venus. The goddess of Venus, being worshipped by some people. See, what happened? She has a temple. They built a temple for her. You have to go to that temple with sacrifice. You go with animals. You go with money. You go with things to that temple. Exactly Judaism. It was just taking what was available on ground. What every other, what Satan has brought. What sin has brought. And just cleaning one up and making one, let's use this one to serve God temporarily before the original comes. So whenever we leave Jesus and go and take our instructions from the Old Testament, what are we practicing? Judaism. And it is not perfect. And no, Jesus has now come. The people that will fulfill what Jesus has promised are not those practicing Judaism. They are only those practicing Christianity. Those who follow Jesus are the ones that will fulfill the promises that Jesus has given. When Jesus said, I go to heaven to prepare a place for you, he wasn't going to prepare a place for the chief priests and the Pharisees and Sadducees. No, it was for his own disciples. All the promises that Jesus gave, all the words, all the good news, all the teachings, were not for the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They were just questioning Christianity. They were questioning because they came with the high of religion. They were questioning why? But those who are following Jesus were saying, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. And that is what is happening today. Many times when we come with the teachings of Jesus, many of us will ask questions and be like, why will you say that? Why? What's happening? We are coming from the side of religion. Religion is why would we do it like that? We've been doing it like this, so what stops us from continuing like this? That is religion. That's what the Sadducees and the Pharisees found difficult in following Jesus. So, when Jesus came, Jesus did not counter Judaism that they were practicing. He didn't come and say, you guys shouldn't have practiced Judaism. He did not say that. But he said, I am now the new vine. I am now the new vine. If we look at the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 and verse 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 and verse 11. It says, according to the grace of God which is given unto me, As a wise master builder, this is by Paul speaking, I have laid the foundation, and another builded thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So, the foundation that has been laid now is Jesus. The foundation of Judaism was broken on the cross, and Jesus said, it is finished. Judaism is finished. Sacrifice is finished. Temple worship is finished. Priest on the temple is finished. Bring your tithe and offering to the temple is finished. Any person that did not come to the temple, your prayer is not answered, it is finished. Spend so much money to build a super temple and have golden cups, golden basin, golden flag, golden eagle, golden angel, and all those things they put, it's finished. Holies of holies, it's finished. Everything that follows Judaism, that foundation is thrown out. There is now laid a new foundation, which is Christ. And only those that build on that foundation are Christians. If you go and take from Judaism and you are mixing it up with Christianity, then what that one is called, a friend gave me a new name, and I like that name. He called it Judo-Christo religion. Judo-Christo religion. That is, you are now taking Judaism, mixing it up with Christianity to form a new religion, because it can never be Christianity. Christianity is Christianity. You can't, once you mix something else with it, it becomes another thing. I used to call it Trado-Christianity. especially in Africa. I call it African religion Christianity, where we go and take our African religion, mix it up with Jesus, and we just stamp the name of Jesus on it and say, okay, we are now calling the name of Jesus. No. When we take foundation of Judaism, mix it with foundation of Christianity, that is not Christ. That is Judo-Christo religion. It's another religion entirely. When we come to Christ, we must come to Christ by letting go the old foundation. That's what the Bible says. When a man being Christ is a new creature, all things are passed away. The old things are passed away. So when Jesus came, the old passed away. Everything that we had in the Old Testament passed away. It became of non-importance to our faith and to our work. Jesus is now the new foundation that was laid. So everything Jesus taught us from the beginning to the end was complete for the Christian life. And when Jesus was going, he said, I have taught you everything. Now, the person that will be reminding you and be teaching you, the only person I'm going to live as a teacher now in this new foundation is the Holy Spirit. Our super prophet, we don't know the person that wrote the book of Hebrew, but by the writing style, we are still suspecting that it's still that brother Paul that wrote to the Hebrews. But in Hebrew, it is written there that Christ is now our priest. So we are no longer having one chief priest on one altar, in one temple, who will go and meet, who is now coming from Holy of Holies. He's the only one that sees God. He now comes out and say, yeah, this is what God told me, the Holy of Holies. And we all say, yes, Lord, final Lord, our chief priest has spoken. No, it's no longer like that. The way it is now is that it's been torn. We now have our chief priest, Jesus Christ. And we all, of course, everybody have access to chief priest. So we all now have access to that chief priest, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. And that is Christianity. So, I don't want this to be too long. And as like I said, God wanted to lay a new foundation. God wants to lay the correct foundation for our Christianity. So every other foundation we have laid, where we go and take from the Old Testament, where they practice Judaism, and try to implement it and stamp the name of Jesus on it, no, that is not Christianity. And such a life cannot enter heaven, because that is not a disciple of Jesus. That is a person mixing everything together. You know, he's mixing everything together. You have to stay true to one. It's either you stay in Christ or you are following religion. So I want you to quickly look at your own life. Which foundation do you have? Majority of us today have the foundation that we can call Judeo-Christo religion, where we take from the Old Testament, buff it up with what we like in the New Testament, and stamp the name of Jesus on it. And if you look at it critically, there are many things in the Old Testament that the New Testament goes a different route entirely. It takes a different route because it was wrong. But it was okay then, because they were practicing religion and God has not come to lay a new foundation. Praise the Lord. Imagine a road on the expressway. The government has not come to say that this is one way. You can only drive one way. It's no more two-way drive. Before the government came and said it's a one-way drive, anyone that passes a two-way drive passes and has no problem. Has no problem at all. A camera cannot record you passing before the law, and you are now arrested for passing. It's not possible, because there was no law. But immediately the government says, this is now how we're going to be doing it. It's now one way. You pass it, you are falling short of the law, and you deserve to be prosecuted and punished with the full force of the law, because you have just broken it. Before Jesus came, after Adam sinned, man went into religion. Man lost God And the only way he could contact God was through a form of religion. And God moved along with them according to that, because he has not laid the correct foundation. Jesus has not come. But after Jesus came and laid the correct foundation, God jettisoned the Old Testament and all its laws and moves and ways of doing things. And that's why when devil tempted Jesus, Jesus did not say, we shall be following after Moses' law to respond. He said, no, man shall not live by bread alone, but by the word that comes from the mouth of God. So it's the only things we are going to hold on in the Old Testament is where God himself spoke. Because God does not change. So where God has spoken, God does not change. But where man have created a law and a way of life to follow a religion, or where God has just allowed them to pass because his son has not come, that is Judaism. We cannot follow that. We now have Christ. We are now Christians. We are no longer under the law. We are now under the grace of Jesus. We now follow the commandments and the teachings of Jesus. We are no longer following the laws of Moses. We are following the laws of Jesus. Our foundation is no longer in Moses. It's no longer in Abraham. It's no longer in Noah or any of them. It is now in Jesus. Our foundation cannot be found in David or Solomon. We cannot take lessons from Isaiah or from Elijah or from Elisha. No. Our foundation is where? Jesus. So if a person never read the Old Testament, never come in contact with the Old Testament, and all he was able to read was Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and follow what is written thereof, that person is going to heaven. If a person never read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and follow what Jesus said there, and the person spent the whole of his life following the Old Testament, that person goes to hell. Because a new law has taken over. A new foundation has been laid. If you follow the old foundation, you are breaking the law. If you follow the whole foundation, you are saying that the death of Jesus on the cross was not enough. So you need to add more things to it. I will end here. I met a young man who was thirsty for power. This was not a story. This is a young man telling me his own testimony personally. And it took a while for him to accept Jesus because of many things that he has done. He went and looked for power. He went to the waters. He went everywhere. Finally, he located there is one book of Moses that follows all the traditions of ritual of Moses, sort of. And when you follow that tradition to the core, powers will manifest. To the extent that this young man was able to follow this, the seven laws of Moses or book of Moses, I can't remember. He was able to follow this book to the extent that it got to a time, you will enter into his house, he will be sitting on the chair, and people will enter his house, they will not see him. He will have disappeared right in front of them. He got to a stage that pastors and ministers were coming to meet this young man for power. Babalawos, witches, were coming to meet him, and he was not using any other thing, but that books of Moses was what he was using to perform the magic and cause and the demonic manifestation he was doing, because there was power. There's power in religion. You could follow religion and perform wonders. You could follow religion and miracles will happen. Signs and wonders will follow. And that's why Jesus said on that day, you all know my favorite part of the Bible now, Matthew chapter 7. On that day, many will come and say, we did this, we did that. And I'll say, sorry, I don't know you. You are a worker of iniquity. You are never a Christian. You were not a Christian. You were practicing Judaism and every other ism you can get. or you went into Judeo-Christian religion, or you went into African religion, Christianity, or whatever you can call it, you miss it all. But you never follow the foundation. You were never a Christian. You never believed me. You didn't believe me enough to believe that whatever I say is final. You were hiding other things to eat. You were practicing all forms of religion, not Christianity. So can you seek the face of God for yourself tonight? Like we always say, go through the Bible yourself. Confirm the things we have said. Then go to God in prayers. Are you truly a Christian, or you are practicing Judeo-Christian religion? Are you truly a Christian, or you are actually practicing Judaism? Are you having the life of Christ, or are you just a religious person? When you say you became born again, was it to Christ or was it to religion? Can you take this matter to God in prayers now? God bless you as you go into your prayers.